Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining us today on Yom HaShoah for this special event. My name is David Leviv. I am a campus advisor at Camera on Campus, and thank you for joining us for today's event. In a moment, I'll be introducing our camera fellow at McGill University, Dordana, who will introduce our speaker and moderate our Q&A for this event. But before I do, I just want to remind all of our attendees on both Facebook and on Zoom that you'll be able to interact with our speaker and with the students on this event by submitting questions either on Facebook Live or through our webinar Q&A function. We'll have staff monitoring both and will help us submit the questions for asking during the Q&A section. Without further ado, I'm excited to introduce Dordana, who is a double major of political science and Islamic and Middle Eastern studies with a minor in social entrepreneurship at McGill University. She is one of the co-founders of the Ramon Movement and is also a camera fellow. The Ramon Movement is a student-led movement with the goal of reimagining Israel education on campuses. She's also the president of Israel on Campus Club at McGill. Thanks so much and excited to welcome you.
Thank you, David. Hi, everyone. We're so excited to have you all here tonight and are so honored to be hosting Eliza Lewin. Eliza is the president of the Louis D. Brandeis Center for Human Rights Under Law, a nonprofit organization established to advance the civil and human rights of the Jewish people and promote justice for all. The Brandeis Center conducts research, education, and legal advocacy to combat the resurgence of anti-Semitism on college and university campuses. It empowers students by training them to understand their legal rights and educates administrators on best practices to combat racism and anti-Semitism on campus. Eliza is also a co-founder and partner in Lewin & Lewin, where she specializes in litigation, mediation, and government relations. Eliza began her law career in Israel, where she clerked on the Supreme Court for Deputy President Justice Menachem Ilan. Eliza is the immediate past president of the American Association of Jewish Lawyers and Jurists. In January 2020, Eliza was awarded the AAJLJ's Distinguished Pursuit of Justice Award. Eliza, you have done such incredible work, and we are so excited to hear from you.
Thank you very much, Dordana, for inviting me. Thank you to Camera. Thank you to all the different organizations that have co-sponsored the event. I'm delighted to be here today. And I thought I would start by just noting that since today is Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Remembrance Day, I thought I would start by just sharing a little bit of my background and my family's history, because my family was personally impacted by the Holocaust. My father was born in Poland in 1936, and he was 3 years old when the Germans invaded Poland, and his family had to flee, and he was smuggled across the border into Lithuania in the middle of the night. I grew up hearing how he was told as a three-year-old that he had to be quiet or the wolves would eat him. And my grandparents they were lucky enough and fortunate enough to receive the first of the visas that were issued by Shiuni Sugihara, who was the Japanese consul in Lithuania at the time, who is considered one of the righteous among the nations. He disobeyed his government's orders and issued thousands of visas to Jews who were seeking a way out of Europe. And my grandparents ended up traveling across, taking the Trans-Siberian Railroad across Russia with one of these visas, and ended up in Japan for a few months, and then came as refugees to the United States. But only one of my father's grandparents, in other words, one of my great grandparents, survived the war. The other three of his grandparents were killed in the Holocaust. And so I grew up knowing this story. I grew up very much feeling like it was this miraculous twist of fate that I was born in the United States and given such tremendous blessing and opportunity by being able to grow up in this country. And I have always felt that with that tremendous sense of gratitude also came a tremendous sense of obligation. And I have felt that it is really meant for me to use the blessings and opportunities that I've been afforded in this country to pay it back, to try and help my community, the Jewish community. And that's really what's motivated me and the work that I do, both at the law firm that I set up with my father, as you mentioned, at Lewin & Lewin LLP, as well as at the Brandeis Center, where now we work to try and combat the resurgence of anti-Semitism that we see, particularly on the university campuses. So with that tribute to Yom HaShoah, now let's talk a little bit about what we see on the university campuses and how we might best address it. So today on campuses, we see that Jewish students are feeling increasingly targeted, marginalized, harassed, excluded, discriminated against on the basis of their Jewish identity. And universities in the United States and in Canada, the administrators don't seem to be taking effective steps to address this harassment and discrimination. And in many cases, they don't even seem to understand that it is anti-Semitic harassment and discrimination. And the question is why? Why have there not been more active steps taken to try and address this? Why is it that this is a problem that still seems to be growing instead of diminishing, particularly when we live in a world that opposes bigotry and opposes discrimination? So I think one of the main reasons is that people today, including university administrators, don't understand two key terms, two key ideas. One is many people today don't understand what anti-Semitism is. And the second is they don't understand what Zionism is. So let's talk about those. What's anti-Semitism? Today, many people, even those who think that they understand or know what anti-Semitism is, mistakenly are only able, I should say, to recognize the anti-Semitism that resembles the Holocaust, right? Here we are, we're talking about Holocaust Remembrance Day. The Holocaust was such a defining moment in our recent history that for many people is what anti-Semitism is all about. So if people see a swastika, they know and say that's anti-Semitic. If they hear or see a Nazi or a white supremacist, they'll say, oh, that's anti-Semitism. But much beyond that, they don't understand. Maybe they'll understand that if somebody who is very visibly Jewish is targeted, then they'll acknowledge that that maybe is anti-Semitism. So for example, if you have a gunman who walks into a synagogue while Jews are in the middle of prayer and opens fire, then they'll say, okay, that is anti-Semitism, like what happened at the Tree of Life synagogue or at the Chabad of Poway. But beyond that, they don't understand what anti-Semitism is. And part of the reason is because while anti-Semitism is one of our society's oldest hatreds, it looks a little different in each generation. It morphs. But there's one constant about anti-Semitism. And that is that whatever the century, whatever the generation, anti-Semitism always takes whatever is viewed as that society's misfortune, whatever is that society's greatest evil, and it pins it on the Jew. So that the notion or the idea becomes, if not for the Jews, the world would be a better place. We wouldn't be suffering from this misfortune. We wouldn't have this evil. So whether it was the Jews were labeled as the Christ killer, or for socialists, the Jews were the capitalists, or for capitalists, the Jews were the socialists, or during the time of the Black Death, the Jews were blamed for the bubonic plague. And we see similarities now when Jews are sometimes blamed for the coronavirus. For the Nazis who sought a pure Aryan race, the Jews were viewed as the ultimate race polluters. So if you think about it, what does today's society see as its greatest misfortune? What do many people today think is the greatest evil that we have to confront, our greatest challenge and misfortune today? It's the issue of racism, apartheid, settler colonialism. And isn't it interesting that that's not an issue that's just pinned on Jews, but rather one of the things that we have in the last 75 years that's new is we have not just individual Jews, but we actually have a Jewish collective. We have a Jewish nation state, a Jewish homeland. And it's very interesting that today, that one democracy in the Middle East, that one place where all ethnicities, all faiths, all genders are all equal under the law, That one democracy is singled out and labeled and targeted by many and alleged to be the worst offender of society's, today's society's greatest evils. The Jewish homeland, alleging that the Jewish homeland is the source of today's racism, apartheid, settler colonialism, that is a contemporary form of anti-Semitism, and yet many people don't recognize it as that. Erwin Cutler, and those in Canada will recognize who he is a former justice minister and former attorney general of Canada. He's now the first who was named to be Canada's special envoy on Holocaust and anti-Semitism. He once explained that the traditional anti-Semitism sought to demonize or marginalize or exclude the individual Jew from his place in society, right? If you think about it, that's what the Yellow Star of David was. Jews had to wear this Yellow Star of David, and they were told, we boycott the Jews. We don't do business with the Jews. We exclude the Jews. We isolate the Jews. We deny the individual Jew his place in society. Today's contemporary form of anti-Semitism seeks to do that to the Jewish collective, to the Jewish homeland, the Jewish nation state of Israel. And it singles out Israel and says, you alone among the nations, you are illegitimate. You have no right to exist. It seeks to deny the Jewish collective, the Jewish homeland, the Jewish nation state, its place in the society of nations. That is today's anti-Semitism. That is the anti-Semitism that many people don't recognize as anti-Semitism. It is not anti-Semitic to turn around and to express your opinion about the policies of the current government of Israel. What is anti-Semitic is to suggest that Israel as a Jewish homeland has no right to exist. That's anti-Semitic. So that's anti-Semitism. Now the question is, what is Zionism? Many people misunderstand what Zionism is. They mistakenly think that Zionism is just a political ideology. It's not. For many, many Jews, in fact, for most Jews, Zionism is an integral part of their identity as Jews. As integral to their identity as observing the Jewish Sabbath or keeping a kosher diet. It's true, there are Jews who do not feel that Zionism is an integral part of their identity as a Jew. But there are also many Jews who do not observe the Jewish Sabbath or who do not keep a kosher diet. However, if you ask a Jew who incorporates any kind of Sabbath observance into their life, and there's a wide spectrum of what that means, they will tell you, if you ask them, why do they do it? They do it because it's an expression of their Judaism. It's an expression of what, of their Jewish identity and what Judaism means to them. By the same token, for many Jews, in fact, for the overwhelming majority of Jews, when they express support for the Jewish homeland, support for Israel, that expression is an expression and a celebration of their identity as Jews. Judaism is not just a faith. It's not just a religion, right? As Jews, we share a common faith, but we also share this common sense of shared ancestry and ethnicity. We believe we're all part of the Jewish people. And as part of the Jewish people, we have a shared heritage, a shared culture. And that shared history, that shared heritage, that shared culture is deeply intertwined and deeply connected with the land of Israel. Jews have been yearning for centuries, right? This is a part of who we are, a part of our identity, to feel connected to this land of Israel. We just finished the holiday of Passover, right? The holiday of Passover celebrates the Jews leaving Egypt, leaving slavery, becoming free, becoming a nation, the people of Israel, and wandering through the desert for 40 years until they reach the promised land. Judaism is so deeply intertwined with this land of Israel that I don't know if you know, but many people don't, but over half of the 613 commandments in the Pentateuch are actually related to the land of Israel and can only be fulfilled in the land of Israel. That's how close the connection is between the Jewish people and the land of Israel. So when Jews celebrate the fact that Israel exists as the Jewish homeland, what they're celebrating is this sense of shared ancestry and ethnicity, right? If a Jew says, for example, I'm excited that the Jewish homeland exists, that the state of Israel exists, that there is one place in the world where the Jewish calendar is the national calendar. So as a Jew, I don't have to worry, as a student, for instance, that I might get an exam on Yom Kippur or on Shavuot, or as an employee, I don't have to worry that I may have to use up all my vacation days to take off for the Jewish holidays. Or here, I know in our neighborhood now, there were conversations and discussions in some of the public schools about whether the first day of the school year this year would be on Rosh Hashanah, on the Jewish New Year. I don't have to worry about that in a Jewish homeland where the Jewish calendar is the national calendar. Or maybe I don't have to worry in the Jewish homeland about getting kosher food. It's easily available and easily accessible. Or maybe I'm excited about the Jewish homeland because Hebrew is a spoken national language. Hebrew, the ancient language of the Jewish people, is an active, flourishing spoken language, or the Jewish culture is flourishing and vibrant. And I'm excited because I enjoy Jewish food or Jewish music or Jewish art. Or maybe I'm excited about all the contributions that people in Israel and the Jewish community in Israel have contributed to the world in the areas of high tech and medicine and agriculture, science, math, literature, you name it, right? If I express pride in any of that, that is an expression of my ethnic pride, my pride in my shared heritage. And yet, if anybody dares to express that kind of enthusiasm today for the land of Israel, they are automatically branded a racist, a colonialist, a lover of apartheid, and they are demonized, they're marginalized, they're ostracized. We see students who are being pushed out of student government. These things have happened at McGill as well as in the United States. They're being pushed out of clubs. They're being told, if you are a Zionist, you are not welcome here. But if you say that to a Jew, then what you are really demanding of that Jew is that they have to shed this part of their Jewish identity in order to be welcomed or accepted on campus in racial and social justice movements. But that is discriminatory, right? Demanding that a Jew shed any part of his or her or their identity in order to be accepted is unlawful harassment and discrimination. We're not talking about viewpoint discrimination here. We're talking about national and ethnic origin discrimination. You do not have to be a Sabbath observer to recognize and understand that discriminating against a Jew because they are a Jewish Sabbath observer is unlawful, anti-Semitic harassment and discrimination. By the same token, you do not have to be yourself a Zionist to recognize and understand that demanding that a Jew for whom Zionism is an integral part of their identity as a Jew, demanding that that Jew shed that part of their identity in order to be included, in order to participate, in order to engage, demanding that they shed that part of their identity is also unlawful anti-Semitic harassment and discrimination. That's what we have to learn to articulate, to explain, and to make clear to the public and to administrators. Students need to learn how to articulate this and convey this so that the university administrators can begin to take steps to actively protect the students from this type of harassment and discrimination that they're experiencing. I know we're going to also speak about the IHRA definition. The IHRA definition is the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance definition of antisemitism. Just a quick note, and then we can get to the questions. There is nothing in this definition that silences or punishes speech in any way. This is a definition. It is an explanation of what a term means, like a dictionary. It's a definition. As I said at the outset of this conversation, many people don't understand what anti-Semitism is. They don't understand how it manifests today. That is why a definition is so necessary. The International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance definition is the gold standard definition. It is the only definition that has been adopted internationally. It was conceived and put together over many years by representatives from governments around the world. It has been recognized by governments, including Arab Muslim governments. It is the most important, most recognized definition. And it's so crucially important for people to begin using that definition today, because if we don't and can't define anti-Semitism, then we can't even begin to try to combat anti-Semitism. And what history has shown is that societies that fail to combat anti-Semitism are eaten up and destroyed by anti-Semitism, because anti-Semitism is like a virus that corrupts the societies that fail to address it. That's why it's so crucial, in order to maintain and protect the freedoms and the liberties that our societies hold dear, that we use the IHRA definition as an educational tool to teach people what anti-Semitism is. Those who oppose the definition of anti-Semitism are people who want to be able to continue to traffic in anti-Semitism without being canceled as anti-Semites, right? They want to continue to engage in Jew hatred without being called out and labeled as anti-Semitic. Those are the ones who oppose the definition of anti-Semitism, because all IHRA does is label what anti-Semitism is. It does not prohibit it. It does not sanction it. It does not make it unlawful. It defines it. And then those who are looking to try and understand what anti-Semitism is are able to use it. I'm happy to take questions.
Wow, thank you so much, Eliza. That was really so amazing. It's always so awesome to hear from you. Does anyone from the audience have any questions? Please feel free to submit them in the Q&A. So just a question for me. It's something we've seen a lot. I'm a bunch of McGill students here. We've seen a lot of recent anti-Semitism on our campus. And it's something they actually released in a statement that they said that they expressed that anti-Semitism was just a bunch of Jewish people complaining that it was just mere feelings of discomfort happening on campus, whereas there were students and there was people in Palestine being killed, and they were trying to make that comparison. So what do you do when you're called out in that way, when these people, they're not accepting the IHRA definition and they're not letting us define anti-Semitism?
So there are a few things. One is, one of the current manifestations of anti-Semitism is actually insisting that Jews have no right anymore to claim that either individual Jews are experiencing hostility or discrimination or harassment, okay? And then to also try and erase Jewish history, right? To erase the fact that Jews historically have been, as a people, targeted in terms of harassment, discrimination, and worse. And so one of the things, as I think you're saying, is any attempt by Jews now today to suggest that they are experiencing harassment is immediately labeled as illegitimate. You don't have a right to say that. But then you can't do that to only Jews, right? To suggest in today's society, when the idea is that we are supposed to, and what we strive for is to create an environment where all are welcome. All are invited to come to the table and bring their full identity to the table. To single out Jews and say only Jews are the only group that's not allowed to come to the table and bring their full identity, that is discriminatory. And it's anti-Semitic discrimination. In terms of the issue of Arab, Palestinian, and Israeli policies, right? There's nothing in the IHRA definition that precludes discussing or challenging or even criticizing those policies, as I said before. Read it. If you read the definition, you'll see. There's nothing in there. In fact, the definition specifically says, criticism of Israel similar to that leveled against any other country cannot be regarded as anti-Semitic. Look at what's happened in Israel now today. They just had their fourth election in 2 years. They may be on the verge of having a fifth election. Part of it is because you have many people in Israel who are critical of the current policies of the government of Israel. That doesn't make them all anti-Semites. That kind of debate you can have, but that's not what's happening on campuses today. What's happening on campuses today is, with increasing frequency, a denial of the right of Jewish self-determination, insisting that Jews alone have no right to self-determination. But if you understand that this yearning for Jewish self-determination is as old as Judaism itself, that from the time of the Bible, right, from the time of Abraham and Moses, right, this has been a part of what Jewish identity is all about, is saying, next year in Jerusalem, like we say at the Passover Seder, yearning for that return to Jerusalem, then insisting that a Jew shed that part of their identity, insisting that a Jew may not yearn for the return to Zion anymore, that is anti-Semitism. That is not a discussion of Israel's policies. That's demanding that I give up a part of what Judaism means to me in order to participate fully in this community.
Yeah, that's something we totally see on our campus, like all these social justice warriors, and they're social justice about everything except when someone's anti-Semitic, it's probably them being the anti-Semite. On a similar note, we have a question also relating in this same topic, so I'm going to go to that one first. The question is, how can we reclaim our Jewish identity as a marginalized people when we are frequently regarded as a white oppressive power in several academic contexts?
So, I find there are two pieces to that question, because one is the insistence on labeling Jews as white. And it's an interesting inverse, if you think about it, about what the Nazis did, right? The Nazis insisted that the Jews were anything but white, right? The Nazis wanted a pure Aryan race, and the Jews were the race polluter. The Jews were not viewed as white. Now, when white is a derogatory term, as I said, the Jews get pinned with the misfortune. Whites are viewed as the source of the misfortune. So if whites are viewed as the source of the misfortune, if whites are oppressors, today's anti-Semitism is going to insist that all Jews, including Jews of color, I will tell you, because I've spoken to Jewish students who are Jews of color, folks have demanded that they must identify themselves as white. They say that as a Jew, they are white, regardless of what their actual ethnic background or racial background may be. And that's today's anti-Semitism. Combating systemic racism, pushing for social and racial justice, that's a cause that is in, as Jews, it's in our kishkas, right? It's in our guts. It's something that we believe in firmly and passionately. We've always, right? That is what one of the principles of the Jewish people when we left Egypt, actually, it's a concept that originated with Judaism, that Jews and individuals are all equal, that we are a society of human beings that are all made in the image of God, right? That was something new in biblical times. That's something that we believe in, and fighting for that and fighting for that equality and fighting for equal rights is something that is a goal of each and every Jew. The answer, however, to combating racism is not to turn around and shift the discrimination from one group to now targeting Jews, right? And part of the problem with what's happening today is that in an effort to combat racism, people are shifting the focus and putting the target on the back of the Jews and saying, oh, Jews are white. So now what we're going to do is take the anger and take the hostility and direct it at the Jews. But Jews aren't white, right? And that's part of the problem. The second piece, though, is in the question about reclaiming our identity as a marginalized, victimized. It is true that with the history of anti-Semitism, Jews have throughout history suffered from discrimination and exclusion and been marginalized. But that's not the identity that we should celebrate, right? We should celebrate the beauty of Judaism. We should celebrate all the positive contributions that Jews have given to the world throughout the centuries in every area, right? What we need is Jewish pride, not a sense of Jewish victimhood. We're not oppressors. We are givers. We are helpers. We are supporters. We are a community that believes deeply in trying to each and every day improve the world in which we live. And that's what Judaism is. That's what Jews have done for centuries. And that's an identity that we should be celebrating.
Yeah. So, okay, we've got a lot of questions here. So everyone, please bear with me. I'm going to try to get to all of them. But at the beginning of that, you did mention the Nazis and how that kind of had a role. So there was a question related to that. So I'm going to do that one now. So it said, the question is, obviously a nation state is a new form of collectivity, but when the Nazis accused a Jewish conspiracy of starting the world wars, weren't they also attacking a Jewish collectivity?
So they were labeling the Jewish people, but at that point, there was no formal Jewish collective, right? Jews were scattered around the world, and the Nazis went systematically rounding up individual Jews. Now you actually have, if you want to call it an entity, right? We still feel that we belong to the Jewish people, but there was no actual entity that you could target, right? There was no, and so the difference is then they were denying individual Jews their place in society. Collectively, yes, it's the whole Jewish people that were being denied their place in society. But today you actually have a formal collective. You have a nation. And what's being denied is that nation is being denied its place in the society of nations. So that's the parallel. Instead of just denying individual Jews their place in society, now there's an effort to deny the Jewish nation its place in the society of nations.
Thank you. Okay, so another question is, what can we do to combat organizations like If Not Now or Jewish Voices for Peace or Ariel Gold, who identify as Jewish and are often paraded by anti-Semites as the good Jews because they are anti-Zionists?
So that's what I mentioned earlier. You will never be able to convince somebody who is anti-Zionist to be a Zionist. Right. There are people who may not know or understand what Zionism is, who maybe once they understand might. But the goal should never be to try and convince an anti-Zionist to be Zionist. The best that I think that we could do is say, look, for me, Zionism is a part of my identity as a Jew. And what you are demanding from me is that as the price for admission, I shed that pride in my ethnic heritage. That is discriminatory. If you're going to agree that I should not be permitted, that no one should be permitted to harass or marginalize or discriminate against any other group on the basis of their identity, then you should not be singling out me as a Jew and saying, well, the only group that it's okay to marginalize and ostracize on the basis of identity are the Jews. I'm not asking you to agree and say that this is a part of your identity. Okay, just like I'm not going to say, even if I may think that the Jewish Sabbath is a wonderful thing, and I'm thankful that I have the Jewish Sabbath, I'm not going to demand and insist that everybody should observe and all Jews should observe the Jewish Sabbath. That's for each person to decide for themselves. But if somebody's going to discriminate against me because I'm a Jewish Sabbath observer, I would hope that even the non-Jewish Sabbath observers would recognize that that's unlawful harassment and discrimination, and that I shouldn't be excluded just because I'm a Sabbath observer. By the same token, I would hope that they would understand that I shouldn't be excluded just because part of my Jewish identity is my Zionism.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, we have a few questions on anti-Semitism and anti-Zionism. So I think there's two that go a bit together, so I'm going to ask them together. So many students on liberal, majority pro-Palestine campuses often argue that the anti-Zionism equals anti-Semitism argument is only used to silence advocates for Palestine. What is a tangible and easy to apply toolkit, i.e. talking points, resources to reference historical facts, expert names, Jewish students can use to explain how anti-Zionism is anti-Semitic and not used to attack Palestinian rights? There's also another question, which was, what do you think are the most important pieces of historical context for people to know about the conflict? So maybe you can answer them together, if possible.
Wow. So for the first, I do think that in terms of understanding anti-Zionism and anti-Semitism, or even for the second too, I recommend, and I don't have any, a very good book on the history of Israel is Daniel Gordis's book, Israel, A Concise History of a Nation Reborn. That book not only gives the history of Israel, the key historical moments, and it identifies and talks about Israel's history, blemishes, warts and all. It does not avoid and make it all pretty, if you want to call it that. At the same time, it also explains how this idea of the Jewish yearning to return to Zion was not something that was invented in the 1800s by Theodor Herzl. Theodor Herzl may have established Zionism as a political movement in the 1800s, but the idea that was at the core of the political movement, as I say, this yearning, this belief in the right of Jewish self-determination in the Jews' ancestral homeland is an idea and a concept that is as old as the Jewish people themselves. And Daniel Gordis in his book goes through Jewish history and explains and shows that. So that's a book that I would recommend as an answer for both of those questions. One of the things that I realized that we didn't touch on yet, and maybe some of your questions will before we go, is the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions Movement, and BDS. So if you want to talk about that, and I don't know if you have some questions on that, we might touch on that too.
We actually don't have any questions directly related to that, but maybe at the end, if there's time, we could talk about it a bit, because I've got plenty of questions on that.
Okay, I think we should. So let's leave some time for that. Why don't you ask another question, and then maybe we'll turn to that.
Okay, so there's another question about anti-Zionism and then two kind of related ones about IRA, and then maybe we could leave some time for BDS after that.
Perfect.
So another question is, one point I've heard in conversation in response to the argument that Israel is the only country singled out as a settler colony is that anti-Zionists also think guilty countries like America shouldn't exist by the same logic. How do you respond to that? How does one express Zionism is definitely not a belief in ethnic cleansing?
So there is, to the last part, you can look at comments and things that were, and statements that were made at the time that show that Zionism, and here I'm talking about then the political movement of Zionism, were never intended as ethnic cleansing. I'll give you an example. Chaim Weizmann, who was the first president of the State of Israel, said at the 20th Zionist Congress, this is in August of 1937, so this is before Israel was even established, but he ultimately became the president of Israel. He gave a speech, and in his speech, he says the following, and I quote, "Permit me at this historic juncture to say a word to the Arab people. We know that the Mufti," this was the Mufti of Jerusalem, who was a supporter of the Nazis and very anti-Jew, So the Mufti of Jerusalem, Amin al-Husseini, and another Nazi collaborator whose name was Fawzi al-Kawkaji are not the Arab nation. In the present world, those who have bombs and revolvers at command wield political power. But in history, in the history of a nation, their life is like one day, even if it extends over years. There is an Arab nation with a glorious past. To that nation, we have stretched out our hand and do so even now, but on one condition. Just as we wish them to overcome their crisis and to revert to the great tradition of a mighty and civilized Arab people, so must they know that we have the right to build our home in Eretz Israel, harming no one, helping all. When they acknowledge this, we shall reach common ground, and I hope for the time that we shall once more recognize each other. So here you have a statement made in 1937 by the person who becomes the first president of the state of Israel. And what is he saying? He's saying, I want to reach out my hand and I want there to be coexistence. I want you to recognize that I, as the Jewish people, also have a right to make our homeland here in this land too. Not ethnic cleansing, not to kick you out, but for us to both be able to live here side by side, that there should be coexistence. That's all that the Jews have still been asking for. The problem is denying the Jews the right to self-determination means that those who are criticizing Israel are not seeking coexistence. They're seeking the destruction of the Jewish homeland. They're saying you have no right to a Jewish homeland here. That's the problem, right? When critics of Israel will say, yes, you have a right to a Jewish homeland in some borders, we may disagree about the borders, well, then we can have a conversation. We can talk about the policies. We can talk about what the right way is or the best way is to balance between human rights concerns and security concerns. We can talk about what the borders should be. We can talk about maybe even what the nature of a Jewish homeland is. But if you're coming from a position where you're saying, no, you don't have a right to a Jewish homeland in any borders. Jews have no right to self-determination at all. Well, then there's no basis for us to begin our conversation. There's no evidence of ethnic cleansing. Look at the statements. That wasn't what Jews wanted. Jews wanted coexistence. And the problem today is there are many people who are not seeking coexistence. They're seeking the destruction of the one and only Jewish homeland.
Yeah, wow, that was really powerful. We actually had someone who really liked that quote and was asking for it. So for the person that asked for the quote, we'll be sure to send that to you afterwards. I'm gonna shift to the two questions on Ira. They both have a bunch of different parts. So it's gonna be a long one. But one question is, does the Ira definition of anti-Semitism encompass anti-Zionism? What are the definition's weak points? What needs to be changed in the definition or in its reception in order to build a defense against anti-Zionism? And then the other one on it was, what percent of the colleges accept and incorporate the IRA definition of anti-Semitism? And how do we create more buy-in to accept this definition? I know that's a lot, but let me know if you need me to repeat any bits.
Yeah, it's good. So the IRA definition does address anti-Semitism in relation to Israel. And it's very interesting to see how kind of the evolution. In the United States in 2010, the State Department actually published on its website its own definition that had been modeled on the early versions, you know, as they were working on putting together the IRA definition. And the State Department definition, which was published in 2010, this was during President Obama's administration, is essentially almost identical to the current IRA definition. The actual definition itself is identical, and then the examples are the same examples, they're just in a different order. And when you look at the State Department's definition of anti-Semitism, and I like to sometimes direct people to it because it helps them understand the current IRA definition. The way they were grouped in terms of the State Department's definition is they grouped the examples according to what was known then as Natan Sharansky's 3Ds. Natan Sharansky, the former Soviet refusnik who then became a member of Israel's parliament, very distinguished individual, he came up with these ideas of the 3Ds to try and understand when criticism of Israel crosses the line into anti-Semitism. And he said, when criticism of Israel either demonizes, delegitimizes, or applies a double standard to Israel, that's when it is anti-Semitic. And the State Department definition actually divided the examples up to these are examples of demonization, these are examples of delegitimization, and these are examples of double standard. The IRA definition got rid of those subdivisions, but that's basically what the examples are. The examples include examples of the more kind of, if you want to say, traditional anti-Semitism, anti-Semitic stereotypes that seek to demonize Jews and marginalize Jews. But it also talks about and includes examples specifically in relation to Israel. It makes clear that blaming Jews, and this happens on campuses often, blaming Jews worldwide for the actions of the current government of Israel, that's anti-Semitism. Comparing Israelis to the Nazis is anti-Semitism. To apply a double standard to Israel would be a form of anti-Semitism. To deny the right of Jewish self-determination by declaring or suggesting that Israel is a racist endeavor since its inception is a form of anti-Semitism. These are some of the examples. You have to remind me again, the second question for a minute was?
The second was about college campuses. So how many have
all right, how they, so there is certainly now in the United States, there is, the IRA definition seems to be on a roll. There are student governments that are adopting it, which is a wonderful thing. And universities should begin to adopt it. Universities should begin to incorporate the IRA definition into their anti-discrimination policies. When university administrators are trying to understand how to deal with what's happening on their campus, they need to deal with it on two levels. On the one hand, they need to look at conduct, student conduct, not speech. They need to look at conduct to see whether conduct violates any of the established student code of conduct rules and policies the university has. If they want to understand whether or not that conduct was motivated by anti-Semitic or animus or bias, the same way you would in a more broad context try and identify, you know, whether something is a bias or a hate crime, you would then look at and try and determine whether it was motivated, what the intent was behind that conduct. The first step is just deciding whether or not that conduct violates the school's policies. Then if you need to decide whether or not the intent was anti-Semitic, you look to the definition of anti-Semitism to understand whether this was motivated by anti-Semitic intent. That's one. The other way that universities need to understand this is universities need to understand how these kinds of anti-Semitic incidents on campus or the repeated marginalization and harassment of Jewish students impacts the climate on campus for Jewish students. They need to understand how Jewish students are feeling not only targeted and marginalized, but are actually being excluded now, as we say, from social and racial justice movements, from campus clubs, from student government positions. And in order to effectively address that, the universities need to start using their own speech. They need to start educating their university communities on what anti-Semitism is, which goes back to the whole beginning of our presentation and the conversation today. And the best way for them to understand what anti-Semitism is and start to try and explain that to students and faculty and other administrators on campus is to use the IRA definition and to say, read it and educate yourself. And then you'll see and understand what anti-Semitism is. So university administrators could use their own voice and can say, for example, that we understand that for many, not all, but for many students on our campus, Zionism is an integral part of their religious and ethnic identity. And we believe that no group on campus should be marginalized or ostracized or demonized or excluded on the basis of their identity. All students need to feel safe expressing their full identity on our campus. Anything else would run counter to the values that we espouse in terms of mutual respect and inclusion and diversity. And so when we see as a university that there are attempts to marginalize or exclude or ostracize the Jewish community on this basis of their identity, we have to speak out against it. We have to condemn it, because that runs counter to all the values that we as a university hold dear. The IRA definition would give the universities the ability to understand and recognize what's taking place as anti-Semitism, so they could call it out the same way they would call out examples of racism or other forms of bigotry on their campus.
Yeah, I think the IRA definition would be something that would be so instrumental on a campus like McGill, where anti-Semitism and its definition is really so contentious among the students especially. So we only have a few minutes left, but we did actually get a question about BDS. So I'm going to quickly read that and then very short time to answer. And this is a loaded question, but how do we convince others that divestment legislation and organizations are anti-Semitic when they claim to only target specific corporations or policies, yet continue to hold Israel to a double standard and are clearly within the realm of BDS?
So one of the things that I think is really important about BDS, a couple of points. One is most people don't understand what the actual original origins of the BDS movement stand for. And if you go and you look up and you see what the three demands of the BDS movement are, you'll begin to understand why BDS is anti-Semitic. Not necessarily all of the people who espouse BDS, because many of them don't understand that this is really what I'm about to explain to you is what it calls for. The first demand of the BDS movement is what they call, they say, end the occupation and take down the wall. So they're talking, presumably, about the area of land that Israel gained sovereignty over in 1967, referred to commonly often as the West Bank or as Judea and Samaria. The idea being, presumably, that if Israel withdraws, whether or not they take down the wall, but withdraws, that that area would then become a Palestinian state. The next demand is to give Palestinians equal rights, but they're not talking about in this Palestinian state in the West Bank or Judea and Samaria, they're talking about equal rights in Israel proper. But Arabs have equal rights in Israel proper already. That's why you actually have one of the Arab parties, people are talking about how it's going to be the kingpin position for this current government, whether or not they will go along with and form a government with Netanyahu, right? There are multiple Arab parties in the Knesset because Arabs vote. Arabs have a right to vote. They have equal rights in Israel. Is there still racism? Like, is there in the United States racism, right? But under the law, Arabs have equal rights. So why is that a demand of the BDS movement? The reason it's a demand of the BDS movement is because the third demand is for the right of return of all Palestinian refugees to return, not to what would be the new Palestinian state created in the West Bank or what was Judea and Samaria, rather the right of return of all Palestinian refugees to Israel proper, to what was Israel in 1948. Well, the Palestinian refugees are unique in that all refugees throughout history, the term refugee has only been used to refer to the actual individuals who fled or left their homes. In 1948, there were maybe approximately 750,000 Palestinians that left Israel, 1948 Israel, and left, which is about the same amount of Jews who around that same time fled from Arab countries and ultimately were resettled in Israel. Many of the Palestinians who left at that time were not resettled in other Arab countries, in part because there was a concerted determination made by Arab countries that they wanted to turn back the clock. They felt that there was never a right, the Jews never had a right to a Jewish homeland in this area. And so what they wanted was to erase the Jewish homeland. And their feeling was that the way to do that would be to demand that the Palestinian refugees had to return back to 1948 Israel. Well, today, instead of just labeling, as traditionally has been, those 750,000 as refugees, what's unique about the Palestinian situation is that they alone are the only group in history where the term refugee has been used not only for those who actually fled in 1948, but for every successive generation. So the children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. So now, according to the BDS website, we're up to 7.25 million Palestinian refugees. Well, if you return 7.25 million Palestinian refugees, not to a new Palestinian state, but to the Israel proper, you will very rapidly, through a democratic process, erase any Jewish nature of the Jewish state. And in fact, Omar Barghouti, who is a founder of the BDS movement, has said he's not looking for coexistence. He says that once you have the right of return, you will not have a Jewish state next to a Palestinian state. You'll have a Palestinian state next to a Palestinian state, a Palestine next to a Palestine. And he has said that never will he allow for a Jewish state in any part of Palestine. So the BDS movement is not calling for coexistence. The BDS movement is calling for the erasure of the one and only Jewish homeland. One final point, which I think is really important to mention when you're combating the divestment movements on campus, is take a look. And what did you see with the Abrahamic Accords? You saw that Arab countries in the region that were not abandoning the Palestinians, but to the contrary, they felt that what is the key to future peace and prosperity in the region for Palestinians and everyone else? It's engagement with Israel, not boycotting Israel. It's not anti-normalization, it's normalization. These countries, Bahrain and the UAE and Morocco and those, they all now, what was the first thing that the UAE did was cancel its boycott law. Sudan just did the same thing, canceled its boycott law, because they've realized that the way to peace and prosperity in the future is to engage with Israel. Who are the people who are still pushing for boycott? Hamas, Hezbollah, Iran. What do these groups have in common? They have actively vocalized that their goal is to destroy Israel. They believe there's no right to a Jewish homeland, and their goal is to end the one and only Jewish state and wipe it off the map. That's what Iran has said. So now the Palestinian Authority has a choice. Which way are they going? Are they going with the Arab countries and the Abrahamic Accords and looking for peace and prosperity by engaging with Israel? Or are they looking to side with the terrorist organizations and Iran who want to wipe Israel off the map? And the question for the students on campus is, how can we, sitting here across the ocean, determine or know better the way to peace and prosperity? And which side are we arguing for? Are we supporting the Arab countries that now have flights, direct flights going back and forth and have business deals that are being conducted? Or are we going to push for BDS, which is essentially supporting the position of the terrorist organizations and Iran, which are seeking to destroy the one and only Jewish state? That's the question for the BDS supporters on campus today. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Eliza, and thank you for everyone who joined us. It was really incredible. Just listening to you speak is so amazing, and I learned so many new things. And thank you so much.
You're very welcome. Thank you, and best of luck. Be well.